Good morning. I want to welcome you in the name of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. This is the day that the Lord has made. Let's rejoice and be glad in it. Again, I want to welcome each and every one of you, those who are on Zoom, as well as those who will join us later on YouTube. We just welcome all of you as we seek to praise and glorify our risen Lord. Do we have any announcements this morning? I know Mike has one. Go ahead.
Good morning. For the men of the church, on April 9th, there's a men's breakfast at Mount Lebanon Presbyterian Church, and the speaker is going to be the president of Geneva College, and I don't recall his name right now. But if you're interested in going, let me know, because I have to reserve a table. All right? Thank you.
Thank you, Mike. Any others? Yes, back to the back.
Good morning, everyone. Happy spring. And speaking of spring, the deacons want to remind you that we want you to spring clean your closets this spring. And we would like you to put aside any gently used shoes that you can't wear or new shoes that you bought and you can't wear. We will be accepting shoes next month. We will let you know the exact dates of our shoe drive, and we will be doing it for Souls for Souls.
I do want to point out, I think Debbie Bender's point, the deacon's point, is not accusing anyone in the church of having a sloppy household. So her command to spring clean is not really for that purpose, right, Debbie? It's to get shoes. So if you have to buy them, if you have to find them, Souls for Souls is a way for us to take shoes, gently used shoes as well as new shoes, to give them to people who don't have shoes. Is that correct?
Yes. Next month, we'll have a video and some other information as to what Souls for Souls actually do. They take shoes and they give it to people in poor
So just because she did not wait for a microphone, but that's all right. Next month, we'll have more information is exactly what Souls of Souls for, correct? Which based, right. So thank you, Debbie. Any other announcements?
The ladies,
yes,
from
Doreen.
The ladies from the church are going to lunch on Wednesday at 11:30 at Applebee's. I've talked to mostly everybody, but if you want to go, come and see me, and I'll add you to the list. Bye-bye.
Any other joys or concerns? What about prayers of joy and concern? Yes, Rich, wait for the microphone. I can't, until I hear a microphone, I don't know what you're saying. Until I get a microphone.
Ukraine.
Now I really couldn't hear that, but I saw your lips move. The Ukraine, yes. Any others? Yes, Nancy Ritchie.
Coming up, Nance.
Prayers for a friend of ours, Kevin Bethel. Kevin is suffering from esophageal cancer.
Kevin Bethel?
Correct.
Okay. Yes.
We have a joy. Our niece Madison, our great niece Madison, yesterday in Georgia, placed second in a science competition. There were 20 schools involved, and her school overall placed first. So she got a silver medal and a gold medal.
Great. So Madison came second in the entire competition in science, and then her team came in first, And she got a gold medal and a silver medal. That's fantastic. And we want to keep our prayers for Kevin Bethel, who has esophageal cancer, and Ukraine, and Lift, Souls for Souls. Any others? Not seeing, then let us center ourselves on the worship of God.
Let us join together in our responsive call to worship. For you save a humble people, but the haughty eyes you bring down. For it is you who light my lamp. The Lord my God lightens my darkness. For by you I can run against a troop, and by my God I can leap over a wall. This God, his way is perfect. The word of the Lord proves true. He is a shield for all those who take refuge in him. For who is God but the Lord? And who is a rock except our God? The God who equipped me with strength and made my way blameless. Let us worship God.
I played this one a few weeks ago, House of the Lord. Let's raise our voices this morning. Good to be in the house of the Lord this morning.
We worship the God who was. We worship the God who is. We worship the God who evermore will be. He opened the prison doors. He parted the raging sea. My God, he holds the victory.
We shout out your praise. There's joy in
Let us go to God in unison and ask for his mercy and grace. Lord of the invisible and the visible, we recognize and rejoice in the knowledge that in your infinite, perfect, and unchangeable will, that you have established a precise plan that we may not understand, but is for our welfare and not our destruction. Yet even as we know this, we rebel against you and seek to do what we want. Forgive us and give us your Spirit to lead us to your Son.
In the name of Jesus Christ, amen. Christian friends, we can often fool ourselves with momentary spans of where we think we're doing pretty good, but we all sin and fall short of God's glory. We all fall to our temptations and the things that draw us to doing what we want to do. Yet even in the midst of our sin, God is there to turn us around and to bring us back to him. So hear the good news. In Jesus Christ, we are forgiven. Amen. Let's remain standing and affirm what we believe by sharing together the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven, and is seated on the right hand of God, the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Please be seated.
Let us pray that God will open our hearts and minds. God of all things, open our minds, hearts, eyes, and ears to your good, acceptable, and perfect will as we hear the word proclaimed and read, and as we receive the word, your Son, into our hearts through the power of your Holy Spirit to share with the world. In the name of Jesus Christ, amen. Amen. Our first lesson is from Job chapter 28, verses 1 through 18. Then the Lord answered Job out of the whirlwind and said, "Who is this that darkens counsel by words without knowledge? Dressed for action like a man, I will question you and you make it known to me. Where were you when I laid the foundation of the earth? Tell me, if you have understanding, who determined its measurements? Surely you know. Or who stretched the line upon it? On what were its bases sunk, or who laid its cornerstone? When the morning stars sang together, and all the sons of God shouted for joy? Or who shut in the sea with doors when it burst out from the womb? When I made the clouds its garment and thick darkness its swaddling band, and prescribed limits for it and set bars and doors, and said, thus far you shall come and no farther, and here shall your proud waves be stayed. Have you commanded the morning since your days began and caused the dawn to know its place, that it might take a hold of the skirts of the earth, and the wicked be shaken out of it? It is changed like clay under the seal, and its features stand out like a garment. From the wicked, their light is withheld, and their uplifted arm is broken. Have you entered into the springs of the sea, or walked in the recesses of the deep? Have the gates of death been revealed to you, or have you seen the gates of deep darkness? Have you comprehended the expanse of the earth? Declare if you know all of this. May the Lord bless this reading and our understanding of his holy word.
We are fewer in number this morning, but we are mighty in sound. It's been a rough year for choir and trying to get with all the pandemic. So we're going to do a little intimate choir for you this morning.
Thank you, choir. It's great to hear you. I want to apologize to the tech. They do such a great job getting the slides up there, and they can only work with what I give them, and I mess up all the time. So it was Job 28, not 20. No, Job 38, not 28. And my bad. So I apologize. But we did have it in the bulletin, and we're reading today on our sermon passage, Romans 12, 1 through 8. So hear these words. The Apostle Paul says, I appeal to you, therefore, brothers, by the mercies of God, to present your bodies as a living sacrifice, holy and acceptable to God, which is our spiritual worship. Do not be conformed to this world, but be transformed by the renewal of your mind, and by testing you may discern what is the will of God, what is good and acceptable and perfect. For by the grace given to me, I say to everyone among you not to think of himself more highly than he ought to think, but to think with sober judgment, each according to the measure of faith that God has assigned. For as in one body we have many members, and the members do not all have the same function. So though many are one body in Christ and individually members one of another, having gifts that differ according to the grace given to us, let us use them, if prophecy in proportion to our faith, if service in our serving, the one who teaches in his teaching, the one who exhorts in his exhortation, the one who contributes in generosity, the one who leads with zeal, the one who does acts of mercy with cheerfulness. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. So does anyone know what the difference between a hippo and a Zippo is? Don't say it. You got to go for the big reveal in a minute. But our passage today, our Romans passage and our Job passage, talks about how God and is precise in all that he does, so that we should know and acknowledge that God's providence for us is not just happenstance. It's not coincidence. It's not just whatever. But a proclamation of his will, which might be invisible to us, but is good, acceptable, and perfect. So, ready for the big reveal? The difference between a hippo and a Zippo. A hippo is really heavy. A Zippo is a little lighter. That is pretty good, isn't it? I wish I'd come up with it, but I'm not clever enough. I can just copy stuff. What's that? That's it. But it also talks about sometimes there's similarities between things, and the similarity is today we're going to be talking about the Nicene Creed. I'm not hearing the cheers we heard just a minute ago. And we just finished going through the Apostles' Creed. And I'm sure everyone was riveted with how they come to learn what the Apostles' Creed means. That the Apostles' Creed was not written by the apostles, but presented ideas for us that the apostles certainly would have used. But it was a personal baptismal creed. It begins with, I believe. And we share that every week. But the Nicene Creed is something a little bit different. It begins with, we believe. For this is the ecumenical creed for the entire church. If you believe and confess, or if you affirm confessions, then you affirm the Nicene Creed, no matter if you're Catholic, Protestant, whatever. We affirm what the Nicene Creed is, because it is the theological creed that was confirmed in 325 by the Church of the Council of Nicaea, and then later on by future councils, that we as Protestants say, we're good. We're good with this. So it would help us. We say it every week, or we say it every month. So shouldn't we know what it means, as opposed to wah 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 wah? Let's just say it, but don't really understand it. So we got to stay focused, and I don't think it's going to take long, because I'm not going to redo the stuff that is similar to the Apostles' Creed. But I am going to do the new stuff. And if you look in your bulletins, beside the Apostles' Creed, there is the Nicene Creed and the Apostles' Creed and the differences. Whatever is bold on the part of the Nicene Creed is what we'll talk about. So that is our focus. And today is, we believe in the Nicene Creed. I believe in, we believe in the maker of heaven and earth, and all things visible, that he created all things visible and invisible. And again, how often do we just say, yeah, okay? Now, when you think about invisibility, is it just invisible to our naked eye? Because germs, for the longest time when the creed was written, people didn't even know what germ theory was. Can't see it, so it doesn't mean anything. But germs are invisible to us, but they're still visible at some point. But it's even more so. If you look at the passage from Colossians 1:16, it says, "For by him all things are created in heaven and earth, visible and invisible." And then it sort of explains it, whether thrones or dominions or rulers or authorities, all things were created through him and for him. Now, you can see Game of Thrones, there's a throne made of swords, but then there's something else beyond that. The concept of authority itself is not a visible thing, it's an invisible concept. And we'll go into that in a minute. Because all creation speaks to the totality of what it is, directing towards a purpose. Our creation is a purposeful creation with a purpose in creation. God has a plan. Now, we might wonder what God was doing before creation. You know, we might think, what was he doing? Well, we can't say specifically, but we do know some things. That he chose us before the foundations of the world. Okay, we know that. We also know that I am the Lord, I do not change. So whatever he was and whatever he has been and whatever he will be, God does not change. But he does have plans. Many of the plans in a person's heart, but it is the Lord's purpose that will prevail. God's purpose and plan is what we really have to focus on. We might think we know what we want, but it's really what God's plan is. I often share with people that, you know, life is like a jigsaw puzzle. Things that happen to us all the time, conversations we have, give each one of us puzzle pieces. Now, we, unlike putting a physical jigsaw puzzle together, can't look at a box top and say, okay, this is what our life's going to look like. We have a picture in our head what our life's going to look like, but suddenly in a moment, things can shift. And that picture is not what we thought it would be. However, God has a plan, and he knows what that picture is. And even when that shift is our own fault, God has a purpose for the things we bring upon ourselves, the pain that we bring upon ourselves. He has a purpose for our pain, a reason for our struggle, and a reward for our faithfulness. As we remain faithful to him, God will reward us, not with like lottery tickets or lottery winnings, but with the realization we are in his plan and purpose, and we are aiming towards the goal that he has set before us. So we are to trust him and never give up. Continually to seek his purpose and will for us. And as we seek it in prayer, he will answer us to the direction we need to be going. Now, and so we have Job. Job is a perfect example of this. A perfect example of providence and pain and perseverance. And Job tries, you gotta give it to him. You gotta give it to Job that he really does try. And he gets it almost mostly right. But he also takes a little bit of a side of whining. And we'll talk about that. But no matter what was happening to Job, and no matter what happens to us, God's purposes can't be thwarted. They can't be denied. Even out of our sinfulness, God's purpose and plan will continue to progress forward. And sometimes, out of our own sinfulness and our taking stepping to one side or the other in our walk with God, taking a break, taking a rest, doing something else, we become more appreciative of God's plan and how it continues to get us where we need to be, if not always where we want to be. And when we sin, the thing about it is God doesn't just abandon us. He doesn't say, oh, you sinned, you did wrong, I'm done with you. For he says in Revelation, as many as I love, I rebuke and chastise, be zealous, and therefore, and repent. Be zealous for God. Be zealous for what he calls us to do. Always keep trying to get back on the path he has laid before us. But we have to first seek that path and want to be on his path and not our own. So we begin in Job 38, 1 and 2. Then the Lord answered Job. Because let me give you a little bit of background. Keep on the slide for a minute. But let me give you a background. Here Job is living large. He has a bunch of kids. He has a lot of wealth. And suddenly, don't get caught up in how the devil and God make a deal. Don't get caught up in that. But all of a sudden, all this tragedy befalls Job. He loses his wealth. He loses his children. He gets physically ill. And he is sitting in a corner covered in sackcloth and covered in ashes. And his buddies and pals come to him and say, you know, you must have sinned because God wouldn't have done this to you if you were righteous. So just repent. Tell God that you're sorry. Repent. And Job is going, I've done nothing. I haven't done anything wrong. Now, Job's wife, we love Job's wife because Job's wife just gently and lovingly tell him in a very supportive way, curse God and die. Okay, that might not have been the best thing to say, but nevertheless, Job doesn't do that. Job doesn't do that. But he does begin to whine. You know, he does begin to complain. What's the deal, God? Why are you doing this? Why am I not getting healed? What's the deal? What's the problem? You know, if it was me, I would do something else. He does say some great stuff like, I know my Redeemer lives, and at the end he will stand upon the earth. Good job, but he does spend a little bit of time complaining. And so God, after he deals with his friends who get it wrong, deals with him, but in, again, a much gentler and loving way than his wife did. And so he says, then the Lord answered Job out of the whirlwind and said, who is this that darkens counsel by words without knowledge? He's basically asking Job, do you know what you're talking about? It's like having a golden retriever do your taxes. You know, really what it comes down to, your dog doesn't have any idea what he's doing. You know, and so often when we think we have the plan that God really needs to follow because we are so much wiser, apparently, than we think God is, we really don't know what we're talking about. We're the golden retriever trying to work the computer. It's just not going to come together. Well, Job goes on. I mean, God goes on. He says, okay, I've done that. But so he asked Job, where were you when I laid the foundation of the earth? Do you have the skill set to do that? I didn't see you crowding me out trying to lay the foundation of the earth. So where were you? You know, you're acting as if this was something within the realm of what you could do. And the reality is, it wasn't in Job's skill set. It's not in our skill set. He goes on to say, who laid its cornerstone when the morning stars sang together and all the sons of God shouted for joy? Sons of God would relate to the angels and to the heavenly host. So again, don't get caught up in multiple sons. Jesus Christ is the only begotten Son of God. We'll get to that later. But where were you? And who did it? You know, we have to understand when it comes to creation, of all things, visible and invisible, it is only God who creates. Man merely rearranges. Catholic theologian Thomas Aquinas said this, and though we're not Catholic, we certainly would agree with that. Michelangelo said it in a little different way. It is only God who creates, we just copy. He goes on to say, the Lord says, who defined the boundaries of the sea as it burst from the womb? And as I clothed it with clouds and thick darkness, for I locked it behind barred gates, limited its shores. I said, thus far and no further will you come. Here your proud waves must stop. Again, God doesn't do anything by half measures. God is a God of detail. Imagine that. God says, this is where the waves will stop. Here and no further. That's a pretty detailed understanding of creation, isn't it? It's not like, well, do whatever you want to do. I don't know. This is where it stops. Take a turtle, and if PETA doesn't get mad at you, flip it on its back and look at the beauty of its underside. God created that beauty that who would see that? That is the God of details in everything. He goes, now, by the way, take the turtle back on us, put it back down on the right, correct side, and let it walk away just to make sure no one thinks. I said, just flip it and leave it. Okay, so anyway. But then God goes on, have you ever commanded the morning to appear or caused the dawn to rise in the east? Again, God is in control. He controls the rising and the setting of the sun. He controls the sun and the moon, the winds and the star, the weather. He controls all aspects because God is in control. And at the very end of this section, which we didn't read, but which continues to, God says, who provides the raven's prey when its young gets when the young ones cry to God for help and wonder about the lack of food? God is a God of precision. God is a God of detail. God is a God that answers us, knows the number of hairs on our head or the lack of hair on our head. He knows us full well. Before we were created, he knew us full well. He knows us full. He knows the number of days we will live and has that plan set out for us. This is not like government work. You know, good enough. Now, again, anyone who's a government worker, I was a government worker for a long time, so I really like government workers, but accept this for what it is. When you can't be fired, you know, sometimes you get an attitude, good enough. No, instead, God is a God that is precise. God is a God of exactitude. I love that word, exactitude. Again, accuracy, precision, correctness, fidelity. God is not a God that just, I don't know, again, it's just, it's good enough. It's like, I decide today I'm going to do this, tomorrow I'm going to do that, and the other day I might do something else, but it's just, if it's within the parameters, I'm good. No, God, it's just like when God speaks about the creation of Eve. He says, a helper fit for Adam. It's not, some translations say suitable. I wouldn't doubt if there's a translation out there close enough, but the precision of the words speak to the perfection of one is the exact match for the other. Because God, as I said, is the God of our heart, mind, body, and soul. He encompasses our complete selves. It says in Romans 12, 1, one of my favorite passages, Paul says, therefore I urge you, brothers and sisters, in view of God's mercy, to offer your bodies as living sacrifice, holy and pleasing to God. This is your true and proper worship. To offer your entire selves. That calls to, as God is a God of our total selves, we are called to offer to God our totality of who we are, heart, mind, body, and soul. We're not to offer God half measures or most of us, but not all of us. We're supposed to offer God all of us because God is in control of all things. We were talking about that in Bible study today. We're talking about the sacrifice of Isaac. And we're talking about how God, Abraham offered the totality of who he was, even knowing that it would break his heart if he had to sacrifice Isaac. But God, being who God is, stopped him and said, you have shown you'll offer your entirety. And God never requests that thing of anyone ever again. So Abraham becomes the father of our faith, given to us the example of how we're supposed to offer the totality of ourselves to God. For God is in control of all things. And Paul goes on and says, do not be conformed to the pattern of this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind. Then you'll be able to test and approve what God's will is, his good, pleasing, and perfect will. We test God all the time. I don't think sometimes we wait for the results. You see, Gideon testing God with the fleece. Okay, God, if it's your will, let the fleece be wet, everything else be dry. Okay, that happened. Okay, now let the fleece be dry and everything else wet. That happened. Gideon still got a little wrong, but God is perfect, and so his plan is perfect. And as we seek to live out his plan, we'll see the perfection of his plan. But so often we don't, because we want to do what we want to do, and that becomes the problem. But when we do leave it at God's, and we do give ourselves to God in totality, we know that those who love God, all things work together for good, for those who are called according to his purpose. You would not be here today if you weren't called according to his purpose. So if you can muster up the energy to love God, then you will work towards his will, which will come to your good. It says, it continues in Romans, for by the grace given to me, I say to everyone, do not think of yourself more highly than you ought, but rather think of yourself with sober judgment in accordance with the faith God has distributed to each of you. This is really becomes the kicker. Why don't we do that? It's so plain in Scripture we're supposed to submit ourselves to God's will. His will is perfect. His will is holy. His will is acceptable. It's good. So why don't we? Because of pride. Because we think we're smarter, we think we're better, we think, maybe not in the clear, like, I'm better than God, we probably don't think that. I'm smarter than God, we probably don't think that. But our practices say, well, I'm going to do what I want, and yeah, God, isn't this what you want because I want it? No. We're supposed to, with sober judgment, with humility, understanding that we are finite, limited, sinful, selfish individuals, that we are limited in so many ways, that we turn to God first and foremost in all that we say and do to seek his will and wait and listen. And sometimes we don't want to wait. We want to do what we want. You know, it's easy to think, and then we blame. I like this quote, not because it's true, because it speaks to, I think, what we all feel. My emotions are invisible, untouchable, invincible even, and their power far outweighs my own. And so it seems unfair that for all the little I can do to them, they can do so much to me. Sure. If we turn ourselves over to our emotions guide us. Is that God's will for us? I don't think so. We go to the next slide. It says, release the invisible potential and begin to do things you were born for. That means all you got to do is release the invisible potential that each one of us has. What does that mean? It can mean whatever we want it to mean if we're seeking our own purpose. If we go to the next slide, it says, intelligence is silence, truth is being invisible. Truth is being invisible. What a racket I make in declaring this, that somehow it's all about us. It comes back, we got to think again. Because all those are so misguided in their how they speak that we should put them aside and ignore them. But that is such a common understanding that we think it's all about us. It's all about emotion. It's all about our potential. It's all about what we want. The reality, it's not about we want what we want. It's about what God wants, because everything was created through him and for him, the invisible and the invisible. Our emotions, our intelligence, all the things that are undefinable, they were created by God. What people see is so much on the surface like the iceberg, but the invisible is so much like that iceberg that is submerged in water. We have to be aware that God is in control of that as well. Not just about what's up here, but what's down here. About our emotions, our feelings, our intelligence, about our potential. God is in control of that. Paul continues, for just as many of us have one body with many members, and these members do not all have the same function, so in Christ we, though many, form one body, and each member belongs to all the others. This speaks to, ultimately, we are one. It's not about our individuality. It's about how we as individuals unite together in the church. And the invisible church, not just the visible church. We're here today. Praise the Lord. We're glad everyone's here today on Zoom, YouTube. Praise God. But even more, as we seek to follow God in the invisible church, we know we have one God, one Lord, one church. That we should have more in common with the Catholics across the street who truly believe Jesus Christ is Lord and God raised him from the dead than the person that's next to us in the pew, present company accepted, of course, that might not really get it. We are united with all those who truly understand that Jesus Christ is in control, regardless of denominational affiliation. That is who we believe in. That is who our Lord is in, and that is a church we belong to. Paul concludes this passage that says, we have different gifts according to the grace given to each of us. If your gift is prophesying, then prophesy in accordance with your faith. If it's serving, then serve. If it's teaching, then teach. If it's to encourage, then give encouragement. If it's giving, then give generously. We are having an offering later on, so all of you folks remember that part. If it's to lead, do it diligently. If it is to show mercy, do it cheerfully. How many people here, before they finished school, said, Lord, what are you calling me to do? What is my vocation? What am I passionate about? What does the world need? What's the calling that is between? What are you calling me to do? We were talking about that earlier again in Sunday school. Sometimes we don't want to listen to God's calling. Sometimes it's easier than other times. But oftentimes it's not at our convenience. It's always at God's direction. But everything that we think we say we want to do, have we tested it against God? What God wants us to do? Do we ask it before we start school? Do we ask it after we leave school? Do we ask it each and every day, what is your calling for me today? With my family, my spouse, my church, my job, what is your calling? Because our job is to be God's tool for the purpose of forming the image of God's Son in our children and in the people around us. That's literally our job. And our vocation does that. Because God is the God of everything. If we walk away with one thought, one understanding, one reality from this, we believe in the maker of heaven and earth, of all things visible and invisible. We believe that God is the God of totality. God is the God of all aspects of existence. There's nothing outside of God's realm of authority. And we submit everything to God in our totality as offering heart, mind, body, and soul in our love for God and our seeking to do God's purpose and plan for our lives. Is it easy? No. Is it what we're called to do? Yes. And as we're called to do it, even if it's difficulty, we will be blessed because God will help us know we are on the track that He has set before us. So let us rejoice that God is the God of all things, both the visible and invisible, for we know that nothing is outside His authority, nothing is outside His will, nothing is outside His good, acceptable, and perfect purpose for our lives. In the name of Jesus Christ, amen. I gotta admit, I'm glad you laughed at that joke because I didn't know what I was gonna do if you didn't. Let's go to God in prayer. Dear Lord, we come to you thankful, that you're not a God of capriciousness, of arbitrariness, of I'll do what I want when I want because, hey, I'm God. But you are a God that does not change, that your purpose and plan was established before the foundation of the earth, just as your calling us to salvation was planned before the foundation of the earth. So, Lord, help us. If there's nothing else we ask you to answer, help us to understand your will for us individually and as a church. We thank you for our visitors today. We thank you for the fact that we're able through technology to communicate with people on a lot of different places. And we thank you so much that you have opened up us to gathering together again, to be able to laugh and enjoy each other in the lobby, and just to reveal how much we've missed each other over these last 2 years. Lord, we ask your blessings on Janet Federkow and on Bernie Hollis, on all those who have fallen or who are struggling with back pain, pain that is preventing them from being as active as you would call them to be. We ask you continued blessings for Susie Dempsey's mother-in-law, Anne Marie, for the people who have passed away, such as Isabel, John Gabber, and others. For Finley Rose, who was born on the 8th, who's just, you know, just 2.8 pounds. You know, be with Tom Fox as he continues to mourn the passing of his brother, Vernon. Be with Patty Wonka's brother-in-law, Tom. Be with Doreen's sister-in-law, Judy. Be with Joyce's sister, Cheryl. She got some really good news. We rejoice at that. Be with Bill Maloney and Judy Butler, with Dan Cork's mom, with Sylvia Sagecatch's son-in-law, Dan. We ask you to be, Lord, with all those in the Ukraine who are suffering, but be with the people, be with the government, but be with the Russians too, Lord, for they know not what they're doing. Be with the government to open their eyes to not do the things they're doing. Be with, we thank you for Madison, who got second place in a science competition and her school got first. For Kevin Bethel, as he deals with esophageal cancer. With our ministry to Souls for Souls and our men's group, our lift group, our Bible studies, for everyone that is doing so much around the church, and we thank you that we are becoming more active. Lord, lay your hand of blessing on us each and every day that to open us to the jigsaw puzzle of life so it's revealed very clearly where we're going. But even when it's not, let us hold firm that your purpose is good and holy and acceptable and perfect. So Lord, just lead us towards that will each and every day. Let us not fall to the right or to the left, but stay on the path that leads us to you, to your Son, Jesus Christ, who taught us to pray together by saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. Christian friends, it's right and proper that God has given us so much that we return a portion to him. We have offering baskets in the back for all those who have already laid their offerings in. We thank you. For those leaving, we invite you to lay your offering in so we can continue the ministry here in Lebanon, as well as those who are on Zoom and YouTube to do the same by mailing their offerings in. The Lord loves a cheerful giver. And as we seek to do his ministry here in West Mifflin, let's continue to proclaim his name so other people can hear about his wonderful will. Let us pray. Dear Lord, we thank you for these gifts. We thank you for the hearts that give them, and we thank you for the love that you extend to each one of us as we seek to be your people. For Lord, we know that that you are our God. In your son's holy name, amen. Christian friends, as we leave this place, we just invite you to understand the totality of what we're supposed to offer to God, because the totality of what God has authority over. Let's go from this place and share with joy that God is in control of all things visible and invisible, of our lives, our vocation, of our hearts, of our emotions, that He is so in control that we are turning all things to Him. And as we do so, people can do the same, will do the same, and His kingdom will grow. Let's go and share that good news. Now may the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the companionship of God's Holy Spirit be upon each and every one of us now and always. Amen. You want me to throw this away?
In Christ alone.